Kathy Erickson, and I would like to welcome you to the TSI Global Aerosol Education Webinar Series. Today, I'm happy to announce that we have a guest speaker, but before I introduce her, I'd like to cover just a few logistical issues with our webinar platform. This is an interactive webinar format, so to keep the audio clear for all of the listeners, because we have quite a few people online, it's best to send your questions in via email. You can also, if you look at your control panel, you have an icon that looks like a hand. You can also raise your hand, and at that point, we will try to unmute your audio so that you can ask your question of the speaker. There also, if you look at your control panel, there's a chat box or a question box that you can send questions, and we can answer the questions at the end of the presentation that way as well. We will be sending a follow-up email to all people who are attending with a PDF file of this presentation. And now, without further ado, I'd like to introduce our guest speaker today. Dr. Sherry Elzey received her PhD in chemical engineering from the University of Iowa under Vicky Gracian. She did a lot of work on nanoparticle characterization, some of which she will talk about today, and has published a lot of references that you can refer to. She was awarded the National Research Council Research Associate Program Postdoctoral Fellowship at NIST, National Institute of Standards and Technologies, to conduct research. So she's currently working on nanoparticle measurements at NIST, looking at nanoparticle measurements and standards. So Sherry, we're very pleased to have you, and I look forward to your presentation.
Thank you, Kathy, and I want to thank TSI for giving me this invitation. Today I'm going to be talking about some work I did while I was at the University of Iowa, where I was characterizing the state of engineered nanomaterials using particle sizing measurements. Our interest in this area stems from the unique properties that nanomaterials can exhibit as their particle sizes become on the nanoscale, which is 100 nanometers or less, 1 to 100 nanometers. And when particles are this small, they can have unique properties such as surface area, surface atoms, surface composition, and so on, that differ from those of the same bulk material. And these different surface features lead to size-dependent properties. And these size-dependent properties can be exploited so that these materials can be tailored and optimized for specific applications. And if you look below at the chart on the left, it shows the number of products and the different types of nanomaterials that are currently on the market. And you can see that silver is definitely the leading product, way ahead of anything else. And if you look at the different product categories on the right, you can see that the category of health products is leading. There is also some food, and I've pointed out goods for children as well, because these types of categories have led people to question the safety of these materials since they are being used in children's products and health products. We really need to understand how they might impact people's health. And so when you consider the entire life cycle of a product, and you look at the beginning where the raw material is produced and you have workers exposed to that material, and then the manufacturing of that product, and then consumer use, of course people will be applying these products, ingesting these products, using them for their intended purpose, and then the end of the product life. How is the material disposed of, and where does it eventually end up? And if you look at this flow chart, you can see that there will definitely be opportunities where these materials can get into aqueous environments, be inhaled by people, and we don't really know where different types of nanomaterials will end up. And so that's a big focus right now on environmental health and safety of nanomaterials. Most people who work in this area agree that the first step to addressing this issue is characterizing the materials. And that's a challenge because of the unique properties of nanomaterials and because their properties can change with time. And so we need to identify instrumentation and methods for measuring these properties, and also metrics, because do we want to measure these materials based on surface area, based on mass? What are the appropriate metrics? And if you look at this figure, you can see that why this is so challenging. Particles can aggregate, their size can change, their surface composition can influence the measurements, they can have different shapes, the properties are dynamic and they can change over time, and concentration can influence the measurements, and all of these different properties can interact to make it even more complicated. But a thorough characterization of the initial material and the properties that it has in different environments are necessary to address these environmental health and safety issues. So my talk today is going to focus on two studies that I worked on. The first one looked at the state of silver nanoparticles in aqueous environments, because silver is the number one product right now that has nanomaterials in commercially available products. And because of its antimicrobial properties, that's usually the reason that it's being used in personal care products. It is being put in products that people are intended to ingest or apply on their skin and so forth, so the safety of these products is really essential. And then my second part of the talk will focus on copper nanomaterial dissolution from the particle perspective. And copper is also being used in skincare products and supplements that people will ingest, in electronics and other products as well. And then I will finish with some concluding remarks. And I want to draw your attention to the bottom, since I am working at the National Institute of Standards and Technology. I need to point out that any materials or instruments that I mention in this presentation does not imply a recommendation or endorsement by NIST, and does not imply that NIST is saying these are the best products available for this purpose. So I'll begin by describing the system that I used to make these measurements. It's an electrospray coupled with a scanning mobility particle sizer. The electrospray atomizer, I will go into more detail in the next slide, but the nanoparticle suspension is electrosprayed and travels through a diffusion dryer so that a dry stream of particles exits the dryer and enters the classifier. The classifier will scan over a range of voltages, and based on the size of the particle, different sizes are allowed to exit the differential mobility analyzer based on the voltage. And so then the ultrafine condensation particle counter will count these particles by condensing butanol to grow them to an optically detectable size. And so the SMPS results in a particle size distribution for a sample. And this system can look at particles between 2 nanometers and 160 nanometers, because this is a nano DMA. It has very good size discrimination. And what we also like to do is couple this system with TEM measurements. And so we insert a TEM collection box between the DMA and the CPC. We just divert the airflow through this box, and the particles are deposited on the TEM grid. And we usually do this overnight to ensure that there are enough particles collected to see on the TEM. And we put it in this location because we want to be sure that we're sampling the same population of particles that are going into the CPC for more accurate comparison. The electrospray aerosol generation takes a nanoparticle suspension and draws it up through a capillary and sprays it into fine droplets. In the ideal situation, you would have what you see on the screen now, which is one particle per droplet, and then the water would dry and you would have a monodispersed stream of particles. But what actually happens, and then you would get a monodispersed particle size distribution. But there's actually a lot more involved. You can have ions in the water or in whatever buffer or acid or base is added. You can have droplets that contain more than one particle, or you can have aggregates of particles within a droplet. And then the aerosol stream is going to be a combination of all of these different particles. And the resulting particle size distribution will be much more complicated. You can have multiple peaks. you can have multimodal peaks, and then you have to decipher what's really being represented in your particle size distribution. So to prepare the samples for analysis, it's pretty simple, three steps. But I would like to back up and start with step zero, as I call it, because we always want to make sure that we're using a material that has been completely characterized in its initial state. So we understand what we're starting with. And we usually use XRG, XPS, TEM, AEFM, BET, surface area analysis, everything that we have available to understand the size and the shape and the phase and everything we can learn about these materials. And then I take the as-received nanomaterial, I add it to a centrifuge vial, and add whatever suspension medium, could be DI water, could be an acid, a base, buffer. I add that to the nanomaterial and briefly sonicate, usually about 10, 20 seconds, just to suspend the material. And then it's immediately analyzed with the SMPS. But I want to mention that something that can happen in the electrospray process, when you have a droplet that contains more than one particle like this, you end up with induced aggregation because those particles will be dried into one aggregate and they'll be measured as an aggregate. And so we always do preliminary studies where we look at a range of concentrations to make sure that we're working at a concentration where we don't have induced aggregation, which for these studies was between 0.5 and 1 weight percent. The silver nanoparticle study aimed to identify the state of silver nanoparticles in aqueous nitric acid solutions as a function of pH alone. So there was no buffer, there was no control of ionic strength to try to simulate any natural waters. This was just a function of pH. So we added the nitric acid solutions to the silver nanoparticles, sonicated, and then immediately put the vial into the electrospray and began measuring size distribution. The initial composition of this material was a silver core with a very thin layer of silver carbonate. This was determined through X-ray diffraction that showed there was no silver oxide on the surface, and then XPS analysis to look more closely at the surface, which showed a small layer of carbonate. The initial TEM particle size distribution, this is just the silver in water with no acid, it showed two peaks. One was mostly isolated particles between 2 and 10 nanometers, and then a smaller peak for agglomerates or larger particles, which were between 10 and 40 nanometers. If we compare that histogram to what we get with the SMPS system of the particles just in water, we get the same peak locations, about 5 nanometers and about 25 nanometers. The intensity of these two peaks is reversed, and we speculate that that could be due to a greater loss of smaller particles to diffusion or lower detection efficiency for the smaller particles that are very near the cutoff of the CPC detection. But the two sizes agree very well. And I would also like just to mention here about the accuracy of comparing TEM histograms to the SMPS data, because some people have questions about whether they are actually comparable if you look at the unit on the axes. The SMPS collects the sizes in bins, so it's on a log scale, and as the size increases, the bin size increases. And that's why the y-axis is normalized to the bin size, so that this histogram is truly representing the count of the particles. Otherwise, of course, you would have more particles counted in a larger bin. And when you look at TEM, this is just a histogram which already has equal size bins of 1 nanometer. Or you could set it at 2 nanometers or 5 nanometers, but it's not a log scale. All the bin sizes are equal, so there's no need to normalize the data. So the data from these two methods are comparable as plotted. So then when we put the silver nanoparticles in nitric acid, we see a size change starting at a pH of 3.5. Above 3.5, there's no change compared to water suspension. We see slight size changes as the particles deaggregate, and then between pH 3 and pH 2.5, we see a very large size change, and then the distributions agree with isolated particle sizes. As we decrease the pH continually, we get smaller and smaller particles as they deaggregate. And below pH 1, unfortunately, we can no longer achieve the stable cone jet mode in our electrospray. That might have been due to the high ionic strength of the acid at that point, but we were in unstable corona mode, and so we weren't able to get a size distribution at that pH. But the change in color indicated that we had dissolution, as the solution turned to a colorless solution, and we confirmed that later with ICP, as I'll talk about later. But we also compared these size distributions with TEM analysis at pH 3, which did show agglomerates, and the sizes agreed very well with TEM histogram, and again at pH 1, where we did see isolated particles, and again, the size agreed very well with the SMPS measurements.
Kevin, a few comments about sound. So if you could speak a little louder, that would be helpful. Thanks, Jerry.
Okay, thank you. I'll try to be a little louder. A visual inspection of the solution showed some interesting color changes. At the higher pHs, 3 and above, we see a gray suspension, which was the initial color of the material. And then when we get to 2.5 and below, we see the yellow suspension down to pH 1, which agrees with the isolated nanoparticles. And this color change occurs at the same spot that the size change occurred as a function of pH. And then at pH 0.5, we see a totally colorless solution, which suggests that we have complete dissolution. On the right here, this is a comparison to bulk silver, which was 10 micron. You can see at the bottom that all of the silver is just settled on the bottom. There was no dissolution at the larger size. So to understand further what was going on, we did ICP-OES analysis. This y-axis is a log scale. I want to point that out. And as a function of pH, we're looking at the percent dissolved silver. For the nanosilver, you can see that there is no significant change in the amount that dissolved until pH 0.5, where it did dissolve, and we're able to confirm that. Something that's important to note here is that between pH 3 and pH 2.5, there's no change in the amount of silver dissolved. So that indicates that the size change we saw at this point was due to deaggregation of the sample and not to increase dissolution of the sample. And comparison with microsilver shows a different trend where there's just a steady increase in dissolution, but very little dissolution even at the lowest pH. If we looked at the zeta potential as a function of the solution pH, we see that at the higher pHs where we had agglomerated particles, we are within a stable zeta potential zone. And then as the particles break up into isolated nanoparticles, they become more unstable. And so this gives some insight into the surface chemical interactions of these particles in the different pH solutions. To summarize this part of the talk, when we put all of this characterization together, we can see a picture of what's happening as a function of pH. If we look at the state, we see the nanoparticles going from agglomerates to smaller agglomerates and breaking up into isolated particles and then dissolving all the way into ions. Qualitatively, we saw a color change that coincided with the change in state. We also saw electric potential go from a stable value to an unstable value as the particles deagglomerated into isolated particles. And then we saw very low dissolved silver, which was steady until the very lowest pH, where the silver dissolved completely. And so this shows us some unique size-dependent properties where there were agglomerates at pH 3 and greater in nitric acid. There were isolated particles between pH 1 and 3, and there were ions below pH 0.5. And it shows how this ES, S, and PS can be used to monitor the state of nanoparticles in aqueous media. We were able to distinguish agglomerates and isolated particles, and we coupled this with TEM, and we were able to confirm dissolved ions by coupling with ICP. Moving into the second study now, talking about copper nanoparticle dissolution from the particle perspective. So typically when people look at dissolution, they're looking at the generation of ions using something like ICP. People haven't really looked at dissolution from the particle perspective, where the particle is getting smaller and smaller as it dissolves. But of course, size is very important for nanomaterials. So we wanted to see if we could use the SMPS system to monitor the particle size distribution in real time and see if we were able to observe the decrease in size as the particles dissolved in hydrochloric acid. The particles that I used for this study had been thoroughly characterized by a colleague in a previous study, and it showed that there was significant oxide. There was a copper core, and there was copper 1 and 2 oxide layers on the surface. We used 0.5 molar HCl because preliminary studies showed that was a good concentration to cause dissolution over a time frame that would allow us to measure it with the SMPS. So we compared the SMPS technique with ICP-OES to see if we could accurately follow the dissolution as a function of particle size. This initial particle size distribution shown at the top is for copper in water, and it's showing a peak maximum at about 15 nanometers. And then we added the acid and took scans at roughly 3 to 6 minute intervals. And you can see the particle size shifting with time. And then a unique feature of multimodal particle size distributions emerges as the particles are dissolving. And this is thought to be due to the different sizes that are present initially in this particle size distribution. They're probably dissolving at different rates, and also could be a contribution from the oxide layers that are on the surface, which could have different reactivity in the acid. And so we see the size shifting over time, and eventually after 30 minutes, we maintain this particle size distribution continually. And so we compared that final particle size distribution with a 1 weight percent copper ion standard, and we get very good agreement, which suggests that at this point we have complete dissolution, and we are simply measuring the copper nanoparticles that are induced from the electrospray process. And here I want to mention, because some people have questions about this shift in size and whether it's related to multiple or the same particle being measured multiple times throughout a scan. And that is not the case, because the DMA scans the voltage from smaller sizes to larger sizes. And since the particles in this study are decreasing in size, once they are measured, they're not going to be measured again as they continually decrease in size, because the scan is going to go to larger sizes and larger sizes. And the DMA only sits at one voltage for a very brief time, on the order of seconds. And once it moves to a new voltage, that's a new size bin. And so the particles in the previous size bin are never going to be measured again, because the time frame of the measurement is so much faster. So there's no such smearing effect or anything like that going on. It really is, these multimodal features really are a result of the dynamic processes that are taking place in real time. when we compare those results with ICP OES data, we see that we get very good agreement. We have the ICP OES and the SMPS measurements show some variation, but overall a very good fit. And we compare this to just water background and water which has had copper nanoparticles removed by the same centrifugation process that we use to remove any undissolved copper. And so we see that the background is zero, and we get good agreement between these techniques. I do want to point out that there's some error associated with these oxide layers, and we tried to quantify how much copper and how much oxygen we had per mass of nanoparticle, but we were not able to do that. But this 83% that was detected on as ions is based on copper content. So this is quite likely indicating 100% dissolution because some of the mass is oxygen. And we did look at other concentrations of HCl. We used 0.5 molar for the study, but in preliminary studies, we looked at a whole range of concentrations that you can see here. And what we found for the lower concentrations was that it did induce a particle size decrease, but it didn't go all the way to dissolution. It just changed particle size with time, and then it was a constant size. So we weren't sure what was happening, if it was just dissolving partially, and then there wasn't enough acid to continue. But we noticed an interesting color change also, as you can see down here, as a function of hydrochloric acid content. And so we thought there might actually be a chemical reaction taking place. And XRD analysis showed that there actually was, and the copper oxide nanoparticles were transitioning into a mineral called paratic hamite, which is what occurs on copper statues that are exposed to the environment. It's called bronze aging. And so I won't go into all of the further analysis that we did with that. It became its own study and its own publication, which was not focused on aerosols. But I just want to mention it here because the SMPS captured these interesting changes and led us down this path into another interesting study. So it's a great way to capture these dynamic changes that can complement other measurements. There are some advantages and limitations to this technique, of course. Some of the advantages are that it requires a very small sample volume on the order of microliters to maybe hundreds of microliters, depending on how long the measurement time is. It gives fast, real-time analysis. The scans, about 2.5 minutes, they can be changed by the user, but when you decrease the time, then, of course, you trade off with resolution. But on average, they're about 2 to 2.5 minutes per scan. They're highly sensitive to small changes in particle size. You can detect half nanometer changes. And it's well suited for dynamic samples that are changing due to interparticle interactions or aggregation, flocculation, or chemical changes like dissolution and reaction. And then it can be limited also by what type of particle you're looking at, what type of media the particles are in, of course, the properties like size and shape and concentration and composition, and then properties of the media also, like ionic strength, concentration of the media can affect whether you can get a stable spraying mode from the electrospray. And so there are, of course, systems that would not be suited for these type of measurements, but for the systems that are, it provides some interesting information. So I just want to make some concluding remarks that we can draw from these studies, that the state of nanomaterials in different environments and the conditions that induce these changes in the state need to be investigated so that we can understand the environmental health and safety effects of nanomaterials and hopefully be be able to develop models that can predict their transformation and fate. And the particle sizing measurements that I talked about today can provide some good insight into chemistry and nanoparticle size changes. And the SMPS offer some advantages that can be used to characterize these particle sizes and their changes to monitor chemical reactions. And these data offer a unique perspective when you compare them to more traditional techniques like TEM, other dimensional, or spectroscopic measurements. I would like to acknowledge my colleagues who helped me with this work at the University of Iowa, and the funding from DOD, EPA, NSF. I've listed the references that I discuss in this paper. This first one is the silver work, the copper dissolution, and the last one is the copper transformation to the paratic hamite mineral. And at the bottom is my contact information. Everyone will be getting these slides emailed to them, so if you have questions that you think of later or questions that we don't have time for today, feel free to contact me afterwards and I'll get back to you. And I also want to thank TSI again for inviting me to give this talk. And thank you for your attention. And if you have any questions, I'll be happy to take them now.
So hi, Sherry. Excellent job. There are a couple of questions in the chat box. There's one, how do you distinguish dissolved silver from nanosilver before ICP OES measurements?
Okay, yeah, I didn't describe that very well. We separate it by centrifugation at 14,000 RPM for 45 minutes, and we confirm that we've removed any undissolved copper or silver by always doing a comparison to the water background and also to water with the nanoparticles removed in the same centrifugation process. And for some reason, I'm not able to see these questions.
Sure, no problem. Another one is the concentration high enough that you could use the 3936 N88 for a faster scan and keep the resolution?
I'm sorry.
So how high is the concentration of your final aerosol particles, typically in DN, log DP sort of numbers?
Oh, it's usually on the order of 10 to the 6, so anywhere between 2 and 5, 10 to the 6.
So quite high.
Yes.
So faster scanning might be a possibility for those.
Yes, I think fast. It's just a matter of what kind of resolution is acceptable for the application.
And then we have one more question. How do these results compare to DLS?
Yes, we did use DLS. However, for these types of studies where you're looking at dynamic processes where particles are aggregating or changing, the DLS did not provide reliable measurements. There was no consistency and no accuracy, so that's why I didn't show any DLS data.
Any more questions for our speaker? Well, if there aren't any more questions, I would like to sincerely thank Dr. Elzey one more time for her time on this topic and also giving us an excellent education. And if you have any questions, you can contact Sherry or you can contact myself, kerickson@tsi.com, and I will get you in touch with Sherry. So thank you very much.